इति तोरयुवानावु परीक्षे बरयुवा परीक्षा वाणियानावु नोडि कलियुवा ಅಂಕಗಳೆಂದರೆ ಮೇಲಿನ ತೊಗಟೆ ವಿದ್ಯೆ ಅದರ ಒಳಗಿನ ತಿರುಳು ಬೀದಿ ತೊರೆಯುವ ನಾವು ಪರೀಕ್ಷೆ ಬರೆಯುವ ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾ ವಾಣಿಯ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿ ಕಲಿಯುವ ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾ ವಾಣಿಯ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿ ಕಲಿಯುವ ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾ ವಾಣಿಯ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿ ಕಲಿಯುವ
ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾ ವಾಣಿ.
Hello children, warm welcome to the revision session. In today's class, we shall learn a chapter from mathematics, a chapter which is easy to simplify, which has only one formula. Which is this chapter? Yes, it is probability. Your guess is correct, children. So in today's class, let us revise the chapter probability. So in our day-to-day life, we come across many sentences like, today it may rain, I may go to party, there's a 50-50 chance of winning a match. Children, here, may, I may, a chance, all these talks about an uncertainty. So, this measure of uncertainty itself is a probability. So, what is a probability? Probability is a science which measures the degree of uncertainty. Children, probability we find in two cases. The very first case, an experimental method. In an experimental method, already the experiment is done and the outcomes we know. For that finding, in a probability is called as experimental approach or the experimental method. Another is a theoretical or in a classical approach. Here, the experiment is not yet over. We are supposed to do the experiment and then finding in a probability is called as a theoretical or classical probability. Children, now let us take a basket which has in a 5 different color balls. Children, now I want to know what is the probability of drawing a red ball from in a basket. Yes, tell me children. Yes, you are right. What is the probability of drawing in a red ball from in a basket containing 5 different color balls? So there is an answer 1 by 5. How did you get 1 by 5? We have already defined a probability of an event. What is a probability of an event? Yes, the probability of an event is number of outcomes favorable to me divided by total number of all possible outcomes of the experiments. Children, here, let us try to understand few words like experiment, outcome, and an event. So here, what is an experiment? Experiment is any activity which yields a result is called an experiment. I toss a coin. Toss a coin, we have a result there. So if we have a result, I say that activity is an experiment. And that result itself is called as a outcome. What is an outcome? Outcome is a result of the experiment. Children, here, what was the result? The result is when we toss a coin, it may be head or a tail. And the outcomes are head or tail. Children, here, also we should know what is an event. Event is a particular outcome of an experiment is called as an event. That is getting a tail or getting a head. These are two different events there. So here, we denote an event by a letter E. And N of E is the number of outcomes of an experiment. For example, getting a head. How many outcomes are there when we toss a coin? We have a one outcome. So we write there N of E is 1. And then all possible outcomes, the set of all possible outcomes when we toss a coin, that is denoted by a letter S. And that S is called as a sample space. Sample space is set of all possible outcomes of an experiment. Children, in that the total number of outcomes are denoted by a letter N of S. Children, here, so probability of an event in a short form can be written as P of E equals N of E by N of S. Children, we shall try to understand some words like equally likely outcomes with the help of examples. The very first example says, a driver attempts to start a car. The car starts or does not start. Children, here, a car starting and not starting are two events here. Are the two outcomes here. These two outcomes depends on whether the engine is in a proper condition, whether there is a petrol in the car. Correct my children? Since the outcomes are depending on a certain factors, we say that the very first example, a driver attempts to start a car and the car starts and does not start, is not equally likely outcome. Now the second, when we move on to a second, a player attempts to shoot a basketball, a player shoots or does not shoot. Children, here, shoots or does not shoot or misses the shot. Here, children, the outcome depends upon the ability of the player and also it depends on how much practice he or she has done. So, that means the outcome shoots or misses the shot depends on certain factors here. So, here, this is also not an equally likely outcome. Children, a mother giving birth to a child. A mother giving birth to a child, here, what are the outcomes? Yes, you are right. It can be a boy or a girl. So, it does not depend on any factor. So, this is an example for equally likely outcome. Tossing a coin. So, tossing a coin, whether I toss a coin inside the room, outside the room, or towards any direction, east or west, what are the outcomes? Yes, you are right. The outcomes are always a head or a tail. Since here, the outcome does not depend on any factor, so we say it is a very good example of equally likely outcome. Children, we can see here a basket with three blue balls and one red ball. Tell me now, is this an equally likely outcome or not equally likely outcome? Yes, you are right. You say it is not equally likely outcome? Yes. Since there are more of blue balls and one red ball, so again here, we say it is not an example for equally likely outcome. It is not an equally likely outcome. Children, now let us move on to an example. There is a question here. Find the probability of getting a head when a coin is tossed once. Also find the probability of getting a tail. Children, here a coin is tossed. A coin is tossed. Probability, what are the outcomes we will have? We have a head or a tail. So, S stands for the outcomes, total possible outcomes, that is a head or a tail. And N of S, children, N of S stands for the number of total possible outcomes. So, how many outcomes are there when we toss in a coin? So, when we toss a coin, we have only two outcomes, that is a head or a tail. So, we can say here, N of S is 2. And the question is, probability of getting a head. So, getting a head. So, here, how many favors a head means? The favoring a head in the total outcome is only 1. So, here, N of H is 1. N of H is 1. And what is the probability of getting a head? Probability of getting a head is N of H by N of S. So, N of H is 1 and N of S is 2. So, probability of getting a head is half. Similarly, children, here probability of getting a tail is N of T by N of S, which is also a half. Children, here one thing you should note, in this particular event, what is the event here? Event is getting a head or getting a tail. How many outcomes are there? See children, getting a head, how many outcomes is there? 1. Similarly, getting a tail, how many outcomes was there? That is also 1. So, here, we should remember that in this particular example, getting an event is 1. Children, let us move on to another example. A bag contains a red ball, a blue ball, and a yellow ball. All the balls being of a same size, Kritika takes out a ball from the bag without looking into it. What is the probability of that she takes out the yellow ball, red ball, blue ball? Children, her bag, in a bag it has a three ball, a red ball, a blue ball and a yellow ball. So your Kritika takes out a yellow ball. What is the probability of taking a yellow ball, taking a red ball, taking a blue ball is a question here. Children, here how many outcomes are there? Here there are three outcomes. How do we denote on a total number of outcomes? Yes, by a letter N of S. Here N of S is 3. So how many in out of the 3, how many are favoring yellow ball? Out of 3, how many are favoring yellow ball means how many yellow balls we can see out of this 3? Out of this 3 we can see only 1. So N of Y is how many? N of Y is 1. N of S is 3 and N of Y is 1. Children, what is the probability of getting a yellow ball? It is N of Y by N of S. How many were favoring yellow? It was a 1. What were the total number of balls in the basket? It was a 3. So probability of getting a yellow ball is 1 by 3. Similarly, probability of getting a red ball is N of R by N of S. Again here, it's a 1 by 3. A probability of getting a blue ball, it's N of B by N of S. It is again equal to 1 by 3. Children, here also in this example also we should observe that here the event is getting a yellow ball, getting a red ball, getting a blue ball. All these events, if you observe, has only one outcome. All these events has how many outcomes? Only one outcome. See children, getting a yellow, that is N of Y is 1, N of R is 1, N of blue is 1. So children, any event which has only one outcome, then such a event is called as, yes, you remember, it is called as elementary event. Children, we should know what is an elementary event. Elementary event is an event which has only one outcome. Children, also in the very first example, we saw that P of H plus P of T was equal to half plus half, which is equal to 1. Also in the second example, we saw that P of Y plus P of B plus P of R, which is equal to 1 by 3 plus 1 by 3 plus 1 by 3, which is equal to 3 by 3, which is equal to 1. Children, what you can observe from this, what we can conclude from this, we can conclude that yes, yeah, already answer is there. They say that sum of probability of an elementary events is always equal to 1. We should note that the sum of probability of an elementary event is always equal to 1. Very good children, this point is very very important. You should note that and let us move on to a complementary event. Children, in the very first example, we have taken the probability of a head plus probability of a tail equals 1. I write probability of a head as probability of a head. Probability of a tail, can I write as probability of not a head? Yes, it can be written as probability of not a head, which is equal to 1. Children, here, probability of not that event is called as a complementary event. So what is a complementary event? Complementary event is an event which is not that event. So that is called as a complementary event. Here, and probability of an event plus probability of its complementary event is always equal to 1. Children, here the event I am denoting by a letter H, and the probability of not a head is denoted by a symbol H bar. Children, you should know here event can be written as a E, or it can also be written by any capital letter. Here I think the head, getting a head, is denoted by a letter H, and not a head is denoted by a letter H bar. So we say P of H plus P of H bar is 1. That is, probability of an event plus probability of not an event is always equal to 1. That is, in general we say probability of an event is 1 minus probability of not an event. children, let us move on to another question. Find the probability of getting a number 8, a number less than 7 in a single throw of a dice. Children, I think the dice, we have been seeing the dice. We have seen a dice is in a cube. It has, very good, it has an 6 faces. And on each face, as we can see even in a picture here, each face there are dots. In one of the face there will be a 1 dot, and there will be 2 dots, a 3 dot, 4 dot, 5 and 6 dot. Do we have 7 dots in a die? Highly impossible, as it has only 6 faces. Correct my children. What are the total outcomes here? I think we have denoted by a letter S. It's a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, a 6. And the total number of outcomes, N of S is equal to 6. That means there are 6 outcomes here. So out of the 6 outcomes, you want an outcome which is a number 8. And getting a number 8 is very good. It's highly impossible. So what is the probability? How many are favoring getting a number 8? Yes, favoring a number 8 is 0. That is N of getting a number 8 is 0. Then what is the probability of getting a number 8? Which is also equal to 0 by 6. Which is equal to 0 by 6, which is equal to 0. It is an impossible event. So children, we should know what is an impossible event. An impossible event is an occurrence of an event which is impossible to happen. Which is impossible to happen. And then we will move on to a second question. A probability of getting a number less than 7. Here, when I throw a die, as already we said, we may get a 1, a 2, a 3, a 4, a 5, a 6. So here, all the numbers are less than 7. So how many numbers are supporting getting an less than 7 means it's a 6. So your N of E is 6 by N of S. So it's a 6 by 6. What is a 6 by 6? Which is equal to 1. Children, here it is sure to happen. Sure to happen means you throw on a die, sure you get one of the outcome will be always less than 7. Such an event is called as sure event or certain event. And also we have defined that the probability of an event is N of E by N of S. Children, here since N of E is in a subset of N of S, it is in a particular outcome from a total outcome. So N of E is always less than N of S, so our P of E will be always a proper fraction. Proper fraction or a decimals, 0. From the above three cases, what we can conclude here is probability of an event can be a 0 when it is impossible, a 1 when it is sure to happen, or it will be a proper fraction if it is not an impossible or a sure event. So probability of an event always it is lies between 0 and 1. Children, let us move to another example. Here 5 male and 3 female candidates are available for selection as a manager in a company. Find the probability that male is selected. Children, now tell me how many outcomes are there here. The total outcomes are 8 here. That is N of S is 8. 5 male and 3 female, there are 8. How many are supporting a male? How many candidates are a male means? It's a N of M is 5. What is the probability of getting a male means? The number favoring male by total number of outcomes. How many are favoring male? Yes, it's a 5 by 8. Children, I think it's done for you. You can check the total number of outcomes is 5 plus 3 is 8, and the number of male is 5, number of female is 3, probability of getting a male is N of M by N of S, which is 5 by 8. Children, here probability of a male and the probability of a female, they are complementary to each other. We should know in this case P of M plus P of F is equal to 1. Let us move to another example. A bag contains 5 red balls and some blue balls. If the probability of drawing a blue ball is double that of a red ball, find the number of blue balls in the bag. Children, usually such question comes for 2 marks. So we should know here, the question is very clear. A bag is there, a bag contains a 5 red ball and some blue ball. That is, how many blue balls are there, we don't know. So, since we don't know how many blue balls are there, let us assume the number of blue balls in the bag be x. So, let the number of blue balls in the bag be x. So, totally how many balls are there in the bag? It is 5 plus x. That is a 5 red and x are blue in number. Given that, probability of a blue ball is twice the probability of a red ball. That is P of B equals 2 into P of R. Now, what is the P of B? Very good. It's a N of B by N of S, which is equal to 2 into N of R by N of S. So, how many are favoring blue? It is X, because there are X blue balls. And what is the total number of balls in the bag? 5 plus X. It is equal to 2 into how many are red balls? 5. What are the total number of balls in a bag? 5 plus X. Children, if you observe there, the denominators are same. We can take out the denominators. What is remaining here is X equals 2 into 5 and the 2 into 5 is a 10. What is the X here? Yes, X is the number of blue balls. Therefore, the number of blue balls in a bag is 10. Children, let us go from another question. A game consists of tossing a 1 rupee coin 3 times and note down the outcome each time. Ramesh will win the game if all tosses shows the same result, that is either all 3 heads or all 3 tails, and loses the game otherwise. Find the probability that Ramesh will lose the game. Children, here a coin is tossed 3 times and we have recorded the outputs. Now here, children, it is a must that we should know what are the outputs. We shall list the outputs here. So we shall see what are the outputs. So here the outcomes is, when we toss first time, you may get a head or a head tail or a head tail head tail. See, children, how I have permitted here. First I have written all 3 head, then 2 head and 1 tail, and the 1 head and 2 tail, and tail head in between and 2 tail on either side. So in the same manner with the tail, I do tail head and a head tail head. Children, here other than this there cannot be any other outcome, and we will see totally how many outcomes are there. So we have 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. Yes, very good. We have N of S is 8. And here, probability of Ramesh winning. Probability of Ramesh winning is number favoring winning by total number of outcomes. So, how many are favoring winning? A favorable outcome for a winning is when you get all 3 head events or when you get all 3 tails events. So, how many are supporting, and out of this 8 means there is only 2. Very good. So, it is 2. The number favorable for winning is 2 and the total outcomes is 8. So 2 by 8 is 1 by 4. Children, also here we should know that a probability of losing plus probability of winning is 1. Why? Because this winning and losing are complementary to each other. What is the probability of losing? Probability of losing is 1 minus probability of not losing. Here is a winning, that is probability of losing plus probability of not losing is 1. What is the probability of not losing? What is the probability of not losing? I think not losing is nothing but it is a winning itself. Probability of winning itself. So what is the probability of not losing? That is also 1 by 4. What is the probability of losing then? It's a 1 minus probability of winning. What is the winning? We have just found out is 1 by 4. Probability of winning is also probability of not losing. So it's a 1 minus 1 by 4, which is equal to, very good, it is 3 by 4. Children, now let us move on to another example. Here, from a well-shuffled pack of cards, a card is drawn at random. Find the probability of getting a black queen. Children, here, before we go for a card, we should know about the cards. Correct, children? So, we shall see how will be the cards. Children, a pack of cards are called as deck of cards. And in the deck of cards, we will have 52 cards. out of which 26 will be black in color and 26 will be red in color. Children, out of 26 black color, we will have 13 club. This particular shape is called as a club. 13 club, 13 spade, and in the red color, we will have 13 art and 13 diamond. Children, in all these four sets, out of the 13 cards, we have one king, one queen, one jack, and we have a one ace, and we have a 9 number cards. Numbered from 2 to 10. We have a 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. In the same manner here, it will be there in a spade also, heart also, diamond also. Children, here we should note that the king, queen, jack are called as a face cards. Now we should go back to our question. What was our question? Find the probability of getting a black queen. How many are supporting in a black queen there? Children, I think in a club we have one black queen. In a spade we have a one black queen. So 1 plus 1, how many black queens we have? Yes, we have a 2 black queens. And probability of getting in a black queen equals number favoring black queen divided by total number of cards, that is 2 by 52, which is equal to 1 by 26. Very good, children. Let us move on to another example. Here, a card is drawn at random from a well-shuffled deck of playing cards. Find the probability of drawing a face card, a card which is neither a king nor a red card. Children, here, we know that total cards, how many we have? We have N of S's 52 here. We know that we have a 52 cards. How many are face cards in that? We have 3 club, 3 spade, 3 diamond and 3? Yes, heart. Totally 3 fours are, we have a 12 face cards. So what are the probability of getting a face card means here? Probability of getting a face card is P of F equals N of F by N of S. What is the N of F there? 12. 12 by 52. When we simplify 12 by 52, we get it as a 3 by 13. Children, here we shall move on to the second question. A probability of neither a king nor a red card. Children, here many students do the mistake. So red card, they take out 26 because there are 26 red cards. And neither a king. So how many kings are there totally? There are totally 4 kings. So 26 plus 4, 30 cards they take out from the 52 cards. And then 52 minus 30, 22 they take. But here it is not so. When you take out only 26 red cards, in the 26 red cards you would have got 2 red kings. Now we have to remove is 2 more black kings. So totally how many cards are neither? Neither means not king nor red. So here, not king nor a red card is 52 minus 26 plus 2. 26 plus 2 is how much, children? 28. 52 minus 28 is 24. 24 by 52. In the simplified form, we get it as 6 by 13. Children, let us move on to another question. In a single throw of 2 dice, find the probability of getting a doublet. Children, here 2 dice have been thrown. Just now we had discussed a dice has 6 faces. Here they are throwing 2 dice and they want a probability. So I want you all to list the sample space. So children, here the sample space I have just left for you. I have just written across. Here the first die may be showing a 1. The second die may also show a 1. So it is 1,1 or 1,2. 1,3, that is the first die may be showing 1, a second die may be showing 3, so 1,4, 1,5, 1,6. And then similarly, first die may be showing a 2, second die may be showing a 1. You have to list it, children. I have left it for you as a homework. 2,1, 2,2, 2,3, 2,4, 2,5, 2,6. Similarly, 3,1, 3,2, 3,3, 3,4, 3,5, 3,6. So here in the fourth row, 4, 1, 4, 2, 4, 3, 4, 4, 4, 5, 4, 6. 5, 1, 5, 2, 5, 3, 5, 4, 5, 5, 6. Similarly, the first die may be showing a 6 and the second die may be showing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, totally how many outcomes will be there means, I think we have 6 row and 6 columns. So, 6 into 6. So, our N of S will be 6 into 6 which is equal to 36. So, N of S is 36. Total possible outcomes is 36. Now the question is getting a doublet. Getting a doublet is an even children. So we should know here the meaning of a doublet. Doublet means both the die should show the same value. That is, the first die is showing 1, second also should show 1. First is showing 2, the second also should show 2. That is the meaning of a doublet here. Now tell me how many doublets are there? Yes, your friend is already saying. We will just check. See children, here favorable outcomes are 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Totally how many outcomes are there? Yeah, N of E is 6. So the required probability P of E is N of E by N of S, that is 6 by 36. 6 by 36 is 1 by 6. Children, in this particular chapter we have just revised what is a probability and two different cases of finding a probability. So also we learned that probability of an event always lies between 0 and 1. It can be a decimals, but it cannot be negative number nor a positive number. We also learned what is an impossible event, what is sure event, what is an elementary event, and many more. Thank you children. I hope this revision will help you. Thank you very much.
Hi students, welcome to the 10th standard science Pariksha Vani. Today let us discuss about chapter Heredity and Evolution. From the examination point of view, this chapter is very important because it comprises many learning points in which we have studied heredity and variations, Mendel's contributions, even law of inheritance of traits, how they get expressed. Next, sex determination in human being and even in other organisms, and basic concepts of evolution, acquired characters and also inherited characters. Next, speciation, how new species are formed. Later, even we have studied evolution and classification, how classification is based on the evolutionary trends. Further, even we have studied tracing evolutionary relationship based on fossil study and homologous organs, analogous organs, and even embryological evidences for tracing evolutionary relationships. Further, how evolution occurs by stages. We will study some examples also in this. Later, human evolution. So many concepts are there in this chapter. Let us once again revise from the point of examination. Importantly, how these characters are transferred from one generation to another generation. Even in the family members itself, we find many variations and also similarities. Why these similarities and variations in the same family members itself? Let us study this by taking an example of family members. Here you can see a lady with a round face and a gentleman with a long face. Now the family members, these couples, they have four children, out of them two male and two female. Now you can observe the similarities with that of the parents and also the dissimilarity, otherwise the variations in what way they differ from their parents. You can notice that. Now the question, why this happens in the family members? Here I have considered that the children of the parents as F1, first generation. Next, we will move on to the second generation also. Here, one of the first generation family. They have one boy and one girl. Look at their physical external features. Do they similar to their parents or grandparents? Yes, they have similar characters as well as some variations. What was the cause for this? That is what we are going to discuss now. Heredity is the transfer of characters or the traits from the parents to their offsprings. In the same way, the differences between the characters or the traits among the individuals of the same species or of the same family members, we call it as variation. The example which we have taken, the same family members, even though they are same family members, we observed many different characters. Those are called as variations. So, heredity and variations, both we will observe in any species or among the same species or among the same family members. Further, again, look at the same family members in a single picture, and you can identify the similarities and the differences or the variations. Next, we will move on to accumulations of variations during reproduction. During the reproduction, when the organisms are giving birth to young ones, during that time, variations gets accumulated from both the parents. But look at this example. Here, this picture depicts the reproduction in case of bacteria. In case of bacteria, reproduction occurs by asexual method, by fission. But here, though it is an asexual reproduction or asexual reproduction, here we are finding little bit of variations. External structure is same, but you find some differences. This difference, it is very less, but still we are finding variations in it. Anyhow, in asexual reproductions, variations are very, very less when compared to sexual reproduction. Why in asexual reproduction variations are very less? Because the offsprings are formed out of the single parent. You can expect question on this. Why variations are less in asexual reproduction? Because all the offsprings are formed out of the single parent. Hope you follow this point. Further, accumulations occurs during reproduction. Otherwise, the DNA gets transferred from parents to offsprings. This occurs by cell division. In body, usually two kinds of cell division occurs in an organism. That is mitotic cell division and meiotic cell division. Meiotic cell division occurs during the production of gametes. Whether it is a mitotic division or meiotic division, the DNA has to undergo copying or replication. During the replication of DNA, sometimes small inaccuracies, otherwise small errors will occur. The error in the DNA copying results in the variation. These variations are very less in asexual reproduction and more in sexual reproduction. Yes. Further, now the question, these variations, whether they are useful to the organism or harmful to the organism. Some of the variations are useful and some of the variations are harmful. How about that? We are going to discuss further. But anyhow, the variations are just because of error in DNA copying during cell division. Yes, students. Further, now, rules for inheritance of characters. We understood that heredity is the transfer of characters from parents to the offsprings or from one generation to another generation. Characters are transferred. How they are transferred? They are transferred through genes. Now, where the genes are present, they are present in the DNA molecule. Where is this DNA molecule is present? It is present in the chromosome. Where do you find these chromosomes? These chromosomes are present in the nucleus of each and every cell. Here you can look at that diagram. In the cell, nucleus is present. In the nucleus, chromosomes are present. So actually each chromosome contains, it is a long chain of DNA. The part of the DNA, we call it as gene, and each gene symbolizes a particular character or trait. And even this gene is also responsible for a synthesis of particular protein that you have studied. So now we understood that all these characters are present in the DNA, and this DNA is a part of the chromosome. Yes, students. Now, how this characters get inherited? Again, we will go back to this. Actually, in sexual reproduction, the organisms receives, any organism, if it reproduces sexually, it receives half of the characters from the father and half of the character from the mother. It is same even for human beings. So human beings, in the child receives half of the characters from the father and half of the characters from the mother. Now, is there any rule for inheritance of these characters? Will it follow a particular rule? Yes. That's what Gregor Johann Mendel conducted experiments with green pea plants to determine the rules for the inheritance of traits. Students, Gregor Mendel conducted experiment on pea plant. Now, let us look at the Mendel's contribution. See, a picture of Mendel, we call him as a father of genetics, because he gave rules for inheritance of traits or characters. Yes. Now come to the Mendel's experiment. He conducted experiment on pea plant. Why especially he conducted on pea plant? Because pea plant has got a many traits which are opposite. Now we should know what is a trait or a character. Take for example, here in this pea plant, one pea plant is tall in nature, the other pea plant is dwarf in nature. The length of the plant body, we call it as a character. Each character has got an opposite trait. The tallness is one trait and dwarfness is another trait. I think you understood the difference between character and a trait. So again, I will repeat, the length of the plant body, you can call it as a character. The character has got a two opposite traits. The one is the tallness, the other one is dwarfness. Okay, here Mendel, why especially he selected the pea plant to conduct his experiments? That's what the intelligence of Mendel lies in, is the success of his experiments. Because as I said, this pea plant has got many opposite traits. It may be the length of the plant body, it may be the position of flower, it may be the color of the flower, it may be the shape of the fruit, and even the shape of the seed. All these factors, they exhibit opposite traits. Because of this, he selected pea plant. Apart from that, this pea plant has got another thing, that it undergoes even self-pollination as well as cross-pollination. Pea plants can be cultivated even in the agriculture land, and even that can be cultivated in the pot. Apart from that, another very important factor why he took pea plant, because its lifespan is short, so that he can conduct many experiments to come out of the rules of law of inheritance or rules of inheritance. Yes. Now, actually what he did, he conducted monohybrid cross. What it means? Let us look into the details of his experiment, monohybrid cross. Here, he took one tall plant and one dwarf plant. Here, tall plant and a dwarf plant, what he has taken, both are pure breeds. What is a pure breed? Look at that. Pure tall plant, which has got, what to say, for each trait, it is represented by a pair of factors. Mendel called it as a factor, but now you can call it as a gene. So that means for every trait, there will be a two genes which will be affecting the character or the trait. In the same way, for short plant or dwarf plant, small t, it is a symbolic representation of what to say genes. In case of a pure tall plant, two capital T letters has used to indicate the tallness of the plant. Apart from that, capital T also says about the dominance of that trait. The small letters also indicates the dwarfness. Dwarf character is recessive in nature. Now we have to know about the dominant character and also recessive character, otherwise dominant trait and recessive trait. Yes, we will discuss that. That's what he did in his monohybrid cross. Students, though pea plant possess many characters, he considered or he observed at a time only one character, that is tallness and dwarfness, how it get inherited into the next generation. When he crossed between the tall plant and the dwarf plant or the short pea plant, it is a cross pollination. He got a F1 generation. In F1 generation, you can see that all are tall plants, but in which when you observe the genotype or genes in it, one is capital T, the another one is a small t. Though it has got both capital T and small t, the F1 generation, all of them are tall in nature. That means here the tallness is getting expressed, but the dwarfness gets suppressed. It is present in the F1 generation, but it is not getting expressed. The character which gets expressed both in homozygous condition and in heterozygous condition is called as a dominant character or dominant trait. Again, I will tell you, the character or a trait which get expressed both in homozygous condition, that is pure nature, and also in heterozygous condition, we call it as a dominant character or a trait. Whereas the recessive trait is one which gets expressed only in homozygous condition and gets suppressed in heterozygous condition, we call it as a recessive trait. Here, short plant is being recessive, shortness is being recessive in nature, which get expressed only in homozygous condition, both the genes are of same types, then we call it as a homozygous, whereas here it is heterozygous, one capital T, another one is small t. Here this small t is present, but its character is not getting expressed in the F1 generation. Hence the short character or the dwarfness is recessive in nature with respect to pea plant. Now let us see continuation of this experiment. In the F2 generation, that is, he took F1 generation plants and conducted self-pollination. Now you should know the meaning between cross-pollination and self-pollination. Cross-pollination is transfer of pollen grains from one plant to another plant of same species, whereas self-pollination is transfer of pollen from the flowers of the same plant. In the same plant, pollen has to transfer to flower of the same plant, or sometimes in the same flower itself, what to say, pollen shift from anthers onto the stigma. That is called as self-pollination. Here F1 generation plants, that is tall plants, and those tall plants are heterozygous in condition, that is one capital T and another one is small t, both are subjected to self-pollination. That is, for F1 generation plants are subjected to self-pollination, then he got F2 generation. In the F2 generation, the phenotypic ratio is in the 3:1, that is a 3 tall plants and 1 dwarf plant. This dwarf plant is very surprising, because in the F1 generation the dwarfness got suppressed, whereas in the F2 generation you are finding 1 dwarf plant or short pea plant. That is, this short peopleness nature get expressed whenever it get an opportunity. When it gets opportunity? Only in homozygous condition. Now look at the F2 generation genotypic ratio. Genotypic ratio in the sense, if you write checkerboard, say I am not going into the details of writing checkerboard, this you have already learned. Just I am asking you to glance that checkerboard or go through the checkerboard once again, so that you will recall all those things, thinking that you know all this. I am asking you to give attention to the genotypic ratio. Here pure tall plant also you will get, and even hybrid tall plant also you will get, and even pure dwarf plants also you will get in the ratio 1:2:1. This is the genotypic ratio. 3:1 is phenotypic ratio. Now what is phenotypic ratio and what is genotypic ratio? Phenotypic means externally how the characters appears. As I said, when you look at a plant in the F2 generation, whatever may be the number, it is always in the ratio 3:1. That means the three plants are tall in nature, one plant is dwarf in nature or short in nature. Whereas when you look at the genotype, see, one is pure tall plant, two of them are hybrid tall plants, and one is pure dwarf plant. See, by conducting mono hybrid cross, Mendel proved two laws, that is, one is law of dominance and another one is the law of segregation. Law of dominance, as I said, the dominant trait or character is one which gets expressed only in homozygous condition, and gets expressed both in homozygous condition as well as in heterozygous condition, and the dwarf character is one which gets expressed only in homozygous condition but gets suppressed in heterozygous condition. The other one is law of purity. Law of purity, the other law. What is this law of purity? Here in the F1 generation or in the hybrid tall plant in F2 generation, you will find both capital T and small t. Even in the F1 generation also same thing. The complete F1 generation is tall in nature, but they are hybrid in nature. That means they have capital T as well as small t. Though this capital T and small t, they are present together in the same plant body, in the same cell, in the same nucleus, in the same chromosome, but they maintain their purity. They maintain that purity. That is what we call it as a law of purity of gametes, because further in the F2 generation you can find dwarfness. Though it was present with the tallness, it didn't lost its character or the trait. It gets expressed in the F2 generation. That means this genes, even whomsoever it will be present with dominant gene or recessive gene, it will be maintaining its purity. Hope you got why Mendel conducted mono hybrid cross. He conducted mono hybrid cross to prove the dominancy, and the second one is law of purity of gametes. Yes, students, further we will move on to dihybrid cross. Mendel also conducted dihybrid cross. Dihybrid cross in the sense, he considered two characters, two contrasting characters. For that, he selected the nature of the seed. In pea plants, you will find smooth surfaced seeds, and also the surface is wrinkled surface. So some seeds are smooth outer surface, in some seeds it is wrinkled. These are the opposite traits. In the same way, the seeds may be yellow in color or green in color. Here, as I mentioned in the monohybrid cross itself, the capital letter indicates the dominant nature. Small letter is indicating recessive nature. Now you can identify in the seed characters which character is dominant and which character is recessive. Yes, you are correct. Roundness is dominant over wrinkled character. Round character is dominant. That's why it is written in capital letter. In the same way, yellow color is dominant over green color. That means you can see round and yellow seeds, round shape, yellow colored seeds. In the same way, you can see wrinkled surface with green color. Yes, I think you have come across such kind of seeds. Okay, now what he conducted? He conducted experiment on this. For that, he subjected the plants with round and yellow seeds crossing with the pea plant with the wrinkled surface with green color. Both of them are pure breeds. Here he conducted cross pollination. When he conducted cross pollination in the F1 generation, he got all round and yellow. Now you can say why he got only round and yellow, because the capital R, the roundness, is dominant over wrinkledness. In the same way, the yellow color is dominant over green color. So in the first generation, all of them are round and yellow. Further, he took F1 generation and conducted self-pollination. During self-pollination, of course, here the F1 generation produces gametes. In the here you can see the female gametes, whereas vertical section you can see the male gametes. Whether it is female gametes or male gametes, they are of four different types. That you can observe. All of you, I think you have practiced it. That's why I am not going much details about it. The checkerboard you have practiced. Anyhow, have a glance at it. When this gametes, four different kinds of male gametes and four different kinds of female gametes are produced by the plants, when they cross, the probability of getting the F2 generation, that will be like this. Here he got what was a 9 plants which are round and yellow, the ratio which I am saying, and 3 of them round and green, 3 of them wrinkled and yellow, and 1 is wrinkled and green in nature, and the ratio we call it as 9:3:3:1. 9, the both dominant characters, round and yellow. The next 3 comes round and green. Here you should focus much. The round and green, it is a new combination of characters. In the parents, round and yellow paired together, whereas in the F2 generation, you can find round pairing with green color. In the same way, here also you can find the new combination, that is the wrinkled nature of the seed is pairing with yellow color of the seed. So here different characters are paired together. Anyhow, even the pure nature of the parental character also retained. That is here the round and yellow, and another one is the wrinkled and green. The important feature what we learnt out of this dihybrid cross is that here he proposed law of independent assortment of genes. Genes, irrespective of whom with they are present, they are free to move and pair with any other character during the formation of gametes and during the fusion of gametes. That is, results in new combination of characters. This is also one of the reason for the variations. Students, definitely you can expect question on monohybrid cross or on dihybrid cross for about 3 marks. Because in this chapter, you will come across many concepts, and you can expect 5 marks major question from this chapter, and 3 marks will be on this Mendel's monohybrid cross and on dihybrid cross. Next, we will move on to sex determination in human beings. Now, in human beings, 23 pairs of chromosomes are present in the nucleus of each and every cell in your body or in human beings' body. But 23 pairs, in the sense, you can also say it as 46 chromosomes, out of which one pair of chromosomes, we call it as a sex chromosomes. and they are denoted by X and Y. In case of females, both the sex chromosomes are of same type, that is XX chromosomes. That means in female, two X chromosomes are present. 22 pairs of autosomes and one pair of sex chromosomes. Together 23 pairs. So that results in femaleness. Whereas when it comes to male, one X chromosome, another Y chromosome is present, together XY chromosome. So the maleness is due to the presence of X and Y chromosome, or mainly due to Y chromosome, whereas in females, two X chromosomes are present. Now, the sperms, when sperms are produced by men, two kinds of sperms are produced, one with X chromosome, another one with Y chromosome, because two kinds of sex chromosomes are present. Whereas in case of females, when eggs or ova are produced or ovum is produced, it will carry only one kind of sex chromosome, that is X chromosome. Now, you can easily say the kind of the sperm fuses with the egg determines the sex in human beings, because all the eggs are of same types, whereas the sperms are of two types, X and Y. Now look at the same here, that's what the chromosome, sperm is having X chromosome and egg is having X chromosome, then if they fuse, it will give a girl child. If a sperm having Y chromosome fuses with an egg having X chromosome, the child will be a boy. Yes, father is responsible for the gender of the newborn baby. That you can look into this diagram, and again you can recall that the kind of sperm which will fuses with the egg determines the sex in human beings. See, here two kinds of sperms, one having X chromosome, another one having Y chromosome. Whereas all eggs are of a same X chromosome. Here X and the sperm with X, it fuses, results in a female. Whereas the sperm with Y fusing with an egg, that is X only, results with male. Hope you understood, students. Variations, whether they are helpful to the organisms or not. Yes, let us study the variations, how the variations are formed, how it is helpful to organism, or how it is useful to the organism by taking an illustration. All of you have studied this. Look at the first chart. Here, all red beetles are there, in which one is a green beetle. I think you can observe this. Now, in a set of a group of red beetles, how come a green beetle? As I mentioned, a variation has occurred in the red beetles. How variation occurs? Again, recall, this variation is due to error in DNA copying. And another important factor what we have to look into this is, all these beetles, they feed on a leaf of a plant. That too, all beetles, they have a specific host plant. Next, these beetles prey for the birds also. Though birds eat many beetles, since the reproduction ability in beetles is very high, large number of beetles are produced. Anyhow, in the environment, the numbers are maintained. Okay. Here, what has happened? Now, a variation has occurred. Among the red beetles, one beetle color changed into green. Now, you can think and explain विच वन हैज द मोर चांस ऑफ सर्वाइवल. नाउ इफ बोथ दिस रेड एंड ग्रीन बीटल इफ इट इज प्रेजेंट ऑन द लीफ which of the beetle can be identified easily? Yes, you are correct. Red beetles can be identified easily. Because of that, they will become more and more prey to the birds. Naturally, the green beetle being camouflaged by the green color of the leaf, survival chance is more. Here, the variation is beneficial to the organism. In the second slide, you can see more number of green beetles and less number of red beetles. Because red beetles are easily identified by the predators. Further, the numbers are reducing. Finally, one fine day, all these red beetles got eaten by the birds and got extinct. Now left behind is only the green beetles. Here variation has occurred in the red beetle. The color changed into green. Now only green beetles are surviving. The red color of beetles got extinct. Such a kind of variation which is beneficial to the organism to adjust itself to the environment, we call it as natural selection. Natural selection due to variation. Here, the variation has occurred accidentally, but it is very much beneficial to the organism. Further, consider this example. Here, first, you are finding only red beetles. Further, a variation occurred due to which the color changed. Here, among the red beetles, you are finding one blue beetle. Now, my question, whether red beetle can be easily identified or blue beetle can be easily identified on a patch of green leaves? Yes, you are correct. Both red and blue beetles can be easily identified. Both of them are easily identified. None of them get camouflaged with the green nature or green leaves. So, this variation, the number increased in the same proportion. See here in the third slide, the red beetles are more in number. The blue beetles are less in number. Of course, numbers are increasing, but less in number. Yes. Now, an unexpected accident occurred. This you have to consider, this situation. An elephant stamped on the small patch of these beetles in such a way that all the red beetles got died by the stamping of the elephant. Only this blue beetles survived accidentally. Further, in the last slide, you can see only blue beetles are surviving and continuing. Here, the extinction of red beetle, whether it is accidental or by natural selection? No. You cannot call it as a natural selection, because the chance of survival of red and blue is the same. Both of them, here the change in the color in no way helpful to the organism to camouflage with the surrounding environment or with the nature. It is as what to say good or bad with a red color and blue color. But how come this red beetles got extinct? That is because of the unexpected event. That means in the nature, because of some unexpected events, some organisms get extinct. In the same way, some characters, some variations continue in the generations or in a species. That is what happened here. The survival of the blue color of the beetle is just an accidental. That means variations, though sometimes it may not be helpful to the organism, just by accidental event it will survive. Yes, now move on to the third condition. Here, acquired traits cannot be passed from one generation to the next generation. Before going to the statement, now look into this, what was a example. Here, the same thing in the first red beetles, even in the second one, red beetles, that means no variations. Whereas in the third slide, you are finding some variation. What is that? The beetles are of small size. Now, whether it is a genetic change, what is that? No, it is not a genetic change. How you can say? Here, this smallness of the beetle is due to the non-availability of the food. Again, here you have to consider a situation that you have studied already. The non-availability of food for these beetles resulted in the small size. This continued for generations. Because same condition, if food is not available, though the genetic character, according to the genetic character, which can grow to a bigger size, it is not possible because environment has to support insufficient nutrition that results in small size. But it is not due to the change in the genes. It is not a variation. It appears to be variation externally, but genetically no variation has occurred. After many generations, once it gets a nutritious food, those small beetles grow to a bigger size or attains its full growth. This clearly says that the change which you have observed externally is not a genetic change, rather it is a acquired trait. What is an acquired trait? In the lifetime of an organism, due to its experiences, it gains some traits or characters. Those traits cannot be passed on from one generation to another generation. Here, the smallness of the beetles is just because of the non-availability of the food. Again, once it gets a food, it grows to its full size. Students, hope you understood these illustrations with three different examples. One with variation due to natural selection, next variation due to accidental, and third one, acquired traits are not passed from one generation to the next generation. That means where the variation has to occur, the genetic change has to take place. Yes. Next, how new species are formed? New species are formed out of the existing species or the old species. The formation of new species from the existing species, it may be due to one or many factors. What are those factors? Those factors may be accumulation of variations, which I said now, in an organism, if it undergoes many variations, that means many genetic changes when it occurs during sexual reproduction and even during cell division, due to error in DNA copying, variations occurs. And because of physical barriers, and even due to genetic drift and natural selection, migration, these are all the factors which results in the formation of new species from the existing species. Now, let us look into the details how these factors causes for the formation of new species. Accumulation of variations. As I said, the variations occurs in an organism. These variations occurred for generations. Several variations occurs over a generations produce new species. That means in a species, individuals of a species, same species, many variations occurs. not in single generation, but in many, many generation, by which many variations are grouped or accumulated in the individuals of the same species, that results in new species formation. Next, physical barriers. Mountains, rivers, lakes, if they are huge enough, if they break individuals of same species into different groups, both the groups belongs to the same species but got divided and they got separated or isolated for many, many years. Now, in both the groups, separate set of variations occurs and they don't have a chance of mixing together because of the physical barriers, but variations are occurring. The set of variation occur in one group and the set of variations occurs in another group, isolated, will be varying, due to which new kinds of species are formed. And another thing you have to consider, when individuals of a new same species, when they divided and get isolated, you cannot expect in both the small groups variations has to occur. In one group variation may occur, in another group variation may not occur. That also leads to the new species formation in which the variations happens. So, physical barriers like mountains, rivers and lakes also contribute to the formation of new species. Species formation or new species formation is also because of natural selection. Here, the nature selects some useful variations which can adapt to the changes in the environment, which has got a more chance of survival. Such kind of organisms produce variations and also new species. This we have studied already in beetle example, where the red beetles undergo some variations due to which green beetles are formed. That green beetle, green color is useful to the organism. It increases the survival chance. That is what we call it as a natural selection. Next, migration. All organisms, especially animals, birds, they migrate from one place to another geographical area, during which, again, this migration also one of the factors which brings new variations and also results in the production of new species. Genetic drift is also another important cause for the speciation, where many variations over a period of long time results in the formation of new species. Yes, students, next, come to the evolution. Evolution is a gradual change which takes place in the living organism, due to which new organism is formed. This new organism genetic composition is different from the earlier organism, so it fails to reproduce with its earlier organism. That means its genetic composition has been completely changed. This change do not occur in a day night. It is a very slow change, gradual change. It needs a very long period. Over numerous generations, many genetic changes occurs, which results in the formation of new species. The formation of new and new species, we call it as evolution. And these new species comes from the existing species itself. Yes. Now, in this, we should focus on inherited traits and also acquired traits. Inherited traits are traits in an organism due to changes in the genetic composition. And it can be passed from one generation to the next. This inherited traits also results in evolution. Next is acquired traits. Acquired traits are the traits acquired by the organism during its lifetime, and it cannot be passed from one generation to the next. This acquired traits do not result in evolution. Next, what are the evidences of evolution? If we say evolution occurred in an organism, is there any evidence for that? Yes, there are many evidences. Usually, homologous organs, analogous organs, and fossils are considered as the evidences of evolution, based on which you can trace the evolution. Yes, now let us study in detail about each and every evidence. Homologous organs. As the definition, these are the organs which are similar in structure and origin, but different in functions. Look at this. Forelimb of human, forelimb of whale, forelimb of dog, and also forelimb of bat. When it comes to origin, from where these four limbs are originated in an organism, it is similar in all these animals. In human, whale, dog, and bat, it is similar. But for its utilization, for its convenience, it has changed a little bit of its external structure, and also importantly, function. Importantly, the function of these four limbs are different in a different organism, but origination is similar. Even if you come to the structure, all the parts of this forelimb is same in all these organisms. Functionally, they are different. Such a kind of organs, we call it as homologous organs. From this, we can draw one more conclusion that since the origin of this four limbs in all these organisms is same, you can come to a conclusion that long back, they were all having same ancestor. Next, analogous organs. These are the organs which are different in structure, that means origin, but similar in function. Look at the wing of the bat, wing of a bird, wing of an insect. In all these organisms, the wings helps in flying. Functionally same, whether it is bat, bird, or insect, which helps in flying. But the origin and the structure of bat wing is entirely different from the wing of the bird, which is completely different from wing of the insect. Here it is exoskeleton origin. The insect wing is exoskeleton origin. When it comes to bird wing, the complete forearm is modified to become a wing, which helps in flying. Whereas in case of bat, only the five digits of the forelimb transformed into a wing. Here, all of them are wings in all these organisms, helps in flying, but the origin and structure is different. Such a kind of organs, we call it as analogous organs. Next, fossils. What are fossils? These are the remains of the organisms which lived long ago. From the fossils, we can know the period in which they lived. That determination of the period, it is of two types, based on the layer in which it is present in the soil. If it is present in the surface layer of the soil, you can say that that fossil is recent in nature. If it is available in the deeper layers of the soil, you can come to a conclusion that fossil is old in nature. Apart from that, the age of the fossil can be determined by radiocarbon dating. Here you can see the picture of a tree trunk, a fossil form of tree trunk. One more fossil, ammonite. It is an invertebrate. Students, fish fossil Nitya and trilobite, an invertebrate, the skull of Dinosaurus rajasaurus, definitely on HOTS you can expect such diagram based questions. So have a look on these diagrams. Yes, we will move on to evolution by stages. Complex organisms and organs developed from simple organisms gradually over generations. This you have studied by considering an example of evolution of eyes. In case of planaria, you will find just eye spots to detect the light. Even in case of insects, you will find eyes. Even in case of octopus, you will find eyes. Here, the organization or the formation of eyes in planaria is entirely different from insects. The formation of eyes in the insects is entirely different from octopus. So, evolution occurred in planaria is simple, whereas in different organisms like insects and in octopus, you cannot compare with planaria because the evolution occurred in those organisms is different. That means in different kinds of species, different similar organs in a different species evolves in an entirely different manner. That is what we called as evolution by stages. Here, in no way this planaria, insect and octopus are compared with each other. Otherwise, they don't have evolutionary relationship with respect to evolution of eyes. Of course, in other factors, in other characters, they may be correlated, they may be related. But when it comes to the evolution of eyes, the evolution of eyes in planaria is different. The evolution of eyes in insects is different. And the evolution of eyes in octopus is different. Next, consider another example, evolution of feathers. Feathers first developed in dinosaurs. The purpose of feathers in dinosaurs, just to protect itself from the cold. Later, birds used them for flying. Now, you can come to a one conclusion. Feathers of dinosaurs and the birds are of same kind. Purpose may be different. Since they are of same kind, definitely you can establish a relationship that birds are evolved from dinosaurs. And it is true also, an fossil Archaeopteryx from which birds are evolved. Next, evolution by artificial selection. Humans cultivated wild cabbage for over 2000 years and produced different vegetables. Now, this is a very good example for artificial selection. Yes, look into the details of this cabbage by selecting short distance between the leaves. Yes, you can see that. This cabbage is developed from wild variety. Cauliflower by selecting sterile flowers. Kale by selecting large leaves. Kohlrabi by selecting the swollen stem. Broccoli by arresting flower growth. Yes, you will be surprised, but all of them are evolved or artificially selected, cultivated by human beings for over 2000 years from wild variety of cabbage. This is a very good example for artificial selection. Hope you followed this. Next, embryological evidences also helps us to trace the evolution. Here, different organisms, that is amphibians, reptiles, birds and mammals, embryonic stage development pictures you are looking. In the first stage, all amphibians, reptiles, birds and mammals, first embryonic stage is very similar, not only in external structure, even in the internal organization. So, by this, you can say that these are all related. They have a common ancestor. Next, evolution should not be equated with progress. Evolution should not be equated with progress. Yes, we studied that the factors which results in the formation of new species. Many factors are there. Due to the evolution, do you mean that the organisms or new species are much progressive than the earlier one? No. Let us not come to that decision. Because, consider a bacteria. Bacteria organization, body organization is very simple. But, when compared to human beings, the organization of bacteria's body is very simple. But, that bacteria is as important as human beings. Otherwise, this bacteria can survive even in adverse situations when compared to human beings. Now, how can you consider a human being is much evolved or much progressive than the bacteria? In terms of environment or in terms of biodiversity, all organisms are same. Whether it is a new species or old species, all of them are same. Then, you cannot equate evolution with the progress. Several species which could adapt to the changes in the environment still continue to survive, for example, bacteria which we discussed now. Human beings have not evolved from chimpanzees. They had a common ancestor from which human beings evolved. Even chimpanzees evolved. Human beings are not the pinnacle of evolution, but they are only species among the several evolving species. In this nature, on this earth, you will find millions of species, among them human being is also one, contributing to the biodiversity. Now come to the human evolution. Human beings evolved in Africa. From Africa, they moved on to all parts of the earth. But they are geographically separated. Still, they possess same characters. Some physical characters may differ, based on which you cannot call it as a new species. Here you can see the stages of evolution. Of course, it is not there for you, but have a look at it. Students, we have discussed so many things, and from the point of examination, Mendel's law and evolution, from both the parts, definitely questions will be there. Our discussion definitely hope it helped you. Thank you very much, students.
ಭೀತಿ ತೊರೆಯುವ ನಾವು ಪರೀಕ್ಷೆ ಬರೆಯುವ ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾ ವಾಣಿಯ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿ ಕಲಿಯುವ
ಖಾಲಿ ಜಾಗ ಭರ್ತಿ ಮಾಡಿ ಹೊಂದಿಸಿ ಬರೆದು ಲೆಕ್ಕ ಮಾಡಿ
ಚಿತ್ರ ಬರೆದು ಭಾಗವ ಹೆಸರಿಸಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಪ್ರಶ್ನೆಗೂ ಉತ್ತರಿಸಿ
ಪಾಸು ಫೇಲು ಗೆಲುವು ಸೋಲು ಜೀವನ ಎಲ್ಲಕ್ಕಿಂತ ಮಿಗಿಲು
ಅಂಕಗಳೆಂದರೆ ಮೇಲಿನ ತೊಗಟೆ ವಿದ್ಯೆ ಅದರ ಒಳಗಿನ ತಿರುಳು ಬೀದಿ ತೊರೆಯುವ ನಾವು ಪರೀಕ್ಷೆ ಬರೆಯುವ ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾ ವಾಣಿಯ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿ ಕಲಿಯುವ ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾ ವಾಣಿಯ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿ ಕಲಿಯುವ ಪರೀಕ್ಷಾ ವಾಣಿಯ ನಾವು ನೋಡಿ ಕಲಿಯುವ